Welcome, everybody. This is Dr. Anton Raimundo on the Flame of Love show on Radio Maria. Thank you for joining us here today. We have as our guest, our very special guest, the U.S. National Director, Eileen Piergiovanni, with us. And she's going to help tell us about the past, present, and future of the Flame of Love and its history and its origin. And also, we want to get to know her own personal story, how she got involved with the Flame of Love. So hang on to your hats and put on your seatbelt, because we're going to go on a ride here and go through all what the Flame of Love is about, and especially know more about our dear friend and director, National Director Eileen Piergiovanni. Let's get started with our tradition of saying the three prayers that we normally do here for the Flame of Love. All right, and let us sign ourselves five times with the wounds of Christ. We offer ourselves to the Heavenly Father through all the wounds of our Savior Jesus Christ. We kiss the wound of your sacred left hand with sorrow deep and true. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We kiss the wound of your sacred right hand with sorrow deep and true. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We kiss the wound of your sacred left foot with sorrow deep and true. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We kiss the wound of your sacred right foot with sorrow deep and true. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We kiss the wound of your sacred side with sorrow deep and true. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And let us pray the rosary, the Hail Mary, that we pray in the rosary with the petition of the Flame of Love. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners. Spread the effective grace of thy Flame of Love over all of humanity, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. And let us pray the unity prayer. My adorable Jesus, may our feet journey together. May our hands gather in unity. May our hearts beat in unison. May our souls be in harmony. May our thoughts be as one. May our ears listen to the silence together. May our glances profoundly penetrate each other. May our lips pray together to gain mercy from the Eternal Father. Amen. And brothers and sisters, and when we pray these three prayers, just recognize that when we do this is we try to blind Satan with these prayers. And the most effective of all is when we are in grace and we do this at Holy Mass. And so also just the explanation of when we pray the words effect of grace, that includes the conversion of sinners and the blinding of Satan, and how we are trying to bring upon us the new Pentecost. And that's where we're coming up, brothers and sisters, you know, in this season of Lent here. And then we're also calling upon the gifts that God will give to us and his church through his Holy Mother. Amen. And so before we get to our special guest, I just wanted to go over some of the different items and news on the Flame of Love website, if you haven't looked at it yet, or the newsletter. And just know that, you know, we will, you know, we have our upcoming national conference that comes up in, you know, in July. And before that, July 24 to July 28, there is a conference for priests and deacons that will be happening in the Malvern Retreat House. So please sign up and ask your priests and deacons to look at this website. In fact, it might be good to just either print it out or show it to them so they can know about the Flame of Love, and just pass out any of the Unity cards. Let them know about it. And because I know that there's a lot of different priests that are very open and interested in this. And some of them, they want to know more, but it just takes us to get them to realize that there's a conference coming up. And then also there's the national conference that all you devotees can go to in Malvern, and yours truly will be there. But Father Blunt is the main headliner, of course, and he'll be there July 28th to July 30th in Malvern Retreat House. And of course, we have, you know, other events happening on the Flame of Love website. You can check out that flameoflove.us or flameoflove-indiana. That's also a great website that you can check out. So let us switch over now to welcome our guest. Eileen, how are you doing today?
Oh, filled with joy, Anton, filled with the joy of the Lord. Happy to be here. Absolutely thrilled with all that you do to help spread Our Lady's flame of love, that we work together and always in unity. Thank you, Anton.
It's such an honor and pleasure to have you here. We are brothers and sisters in Christ as lay Carmelites. We both live out here in the Philadelphia region, and she is such a joy to me and an inspiration. It's been a long time coming to have you here. Sorry it took you took me that long to have you on the show, and I'm just so privileged that you're here. That I would love the audience to just know your story, because you know you've told it to me a couple of times, and I just I'm just so enthralled and just so amazed at how the Lord has worked in your life and to bring this about, and how you also came to be in the Flame of Love and the National Director, and to have it go through all the different events, you know, from COVID to current. So we want to hear your take on, like, how did you get involved with the Flame of Love? Please just share whatever you like with our listeners here.
I'd be happy to, Anton. First, I'd like to say a Hail Mary for Our Lady's guidance. And one thing that I think is important for all of us, whenever I start a conversation, I hope to remember every time I start a conversation with any one of the Flame of Love prayer warriors, it's to start with the Hail Mary and ask for Our Lady to join us in prayer. And so I pray, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners. Spread the effective grace of thy flame of love over all of humanity. And so one thing we always have to remember, it's Our Lady's movement to put her first, and she always puts Jesus first. And this is Our Lady's flame of love. And the flame of love is such a powerful gift from God, from Our Lady, for our time, specifically for our time. And it blinds Satan and saves souls. That's how powerful it is. In the United States, it has spread like wildfire. And she mentions that word in the diary. It's absolutely true. It has spread and formed little groups. By that, many people still may not have heard of it, but so many have. And what happens to the person who hears about it, their heart is touched. It's a movement of the heart. And so when their heart is touched, they begin to pray. And inside the home, in the family, they pray. It's a family sanctuary. It's a family prayer group. Inside the little parish where the group gathers before or after Mass in adoration, or just if they're allowed to go into the church and pray together, 2, 3, 4, 10 people, they pray together, heart to heart, and the joy comes. It's a movement of joy. And so this is how it's spread. Not huge events, though we do have some pretty big events, but it's because little hearts are touched, and it brings the people back to Jesus and Mary. And then they share that with their family, and they grow in unity in the family, in the little group with Jesus and Mary. And that's what we're all trying to do, is get closer to God, because God is everything. So again, the Eucharist is the center of the flame of love. And so if anybody prays in adoration or at the Holy Mass, it's beautiful, but it's always beautiful. As Father Blunt would say, it is beautiful. Beautiful. So, the flame of love. And I started to say, too, that the heart is everything. And the flame of love spreads heart to heart. So, it's our individual touching of someone else with the flame of love that makes this spread. And so, through this, everyone grows closer to Jesus and Mary. And they begin these little prayer cenacles, prayer groups. We call them a cenacle because the cenacle is the upper room. The upper room is very important right now as we get near Pentecost. It's where the apostles gathered for the Last Supper, where they gathered after Jesus died and was resurrected, often with our Blessed Mother, and prayed sometimes in fear, probably. They didn't know what was going to happen, but they prayed in the upper room and amazing things happened. And so this is all about our joy. And so, another thing before I begin my story is, as I talk, just think about Our Lady and Jesus, because the image of Our Lady is what should be in your front of your eyes. We have a special image, the Holy Card. It's our Blessed Mother, And from that image, you see her heart is bursting. It's a flame of love bursting out of her heart. The flame of love is Jesus Christ himself. She tells us that. She always puts Jesus first. The flame is so powerful. It's bursting out of her heart. It's something she can't contain. It's coming out to each one of us individually. And so when you look at that image, understand the greatness of what you're looking at, the joy that comes from that. All of us work with that. So from myself and everyone, work with Ampey in the flame of love. I never thought that would happen, but it did. We're all servants for Our Lady. I had no idea how it would. I never did anything. I couldn't do that. Our Lady did everything. So I think that's amazing. I'll talk about that more later on. And then extraordinary grace. So we have this amazing, extraordinary grace that is available to us because of the flame of love, because of this gift that Our Lady's giving to us. And this grace is so powerful. Anton said it, I'll say it probably many times, it blinds Satan. The evil in today's world is tangible. You can actually feel it. You don't want to go outside sometimes. You don't turn on your TV or the internet. What's going to be out there for you and your family and your children? But instead, pray a little Hail Mary and the grace will come. Satan is blinded. Souls are saved. And let's see, where was I going to go from here? Our Lady is the one who leads the flame of love in the United States. So I have a title, but it means nothing. It's always Our Lady and all the servants who gather together and spread the flame of love. That's how it spreads. Jesus and Mary are everything. And when I look at the image and I see her image, and if I look at a holy face of Jesus, whether it's from the Shroud of Turin or the face of Manipello or Veronica, or an image of Jesus as the Good Shepherd we just had this week, I'm filled with joy because I know how much they love us. And Anton, you always put Jesus and Mary first. You always, on these radio programs and in your talks, your humility and your purity of intention, as well as your obedience to God, always amazes me. And as you as national spokesperson, Anton, I want you to know that it was your great humility and after your love that my heart was touched. And it was, we prayed and discerned. I talked to Monsignor Schifo and we prayed and we discerned and we decided that you were the one who should be the national spokesperson. And they're the reasons, even though you're a great speaker too, it has more to do with your devotion to Jesus and Mary, why I think Our Lady chose you. So I want everyone to know about the amazing gifts you have. Getting ready for the show, I wanted to prepare actually a list of your talks, and I don't even have anything ready. So I'm going to get that together, but I want everyone to know that Anton's talks will be available, that he was chosen by Our Lady as the U.S. national spokesperson, and that you should contact him if you want him to speak, and whether he travels or speaks virtually. I mean, it doesn't matter. He engages everyone. And you can reach Anton by going to our website. What is our website? Flameoflove.us and yes. flameoflove.us. And if you go to contacts, it says ask a question. Also, you'll scroll down, you'll see Anton's picture, my picture, and you can contact each one of us individually by clicking on that. And let us know if you want him to come and speak. We need his help because he speaks for Jesus and Mary. He speaks for the flame of love. And so thank you, Anton. You're amazing. Well,
thank you, Eileen. I didn't expect that at all. In audience, I did put her as a plant here or plant her to say all this, okay? She just came out and said this. So, but I appreciate that, Eileen. And I just feel blessed that I'm here to help Our Lady and our Lord bring upon this to the church because we're seeing so many conversions, people's heart being changed. And it's just so... you could just feel this wave, this tsunami of grace just spilling over it onto the nation. And we need this. We need the healing. We need the love. We need the mercy. And the flame of love helps catalyze, you know, it's a catalyst to all this. And so, again, thank you, Eileen.
Well, Anton, I didn't know I was going to say it either. How's that? It's always from Our Lady. It has to be from God. It has to be from God. So I did write this down, though. I want to say a special prayer, and I want the whole audience, if you're listening, to pray with me. then this will also go up on the website. So everyone will hear this, that I want everyone to pray for Our Lady's intercession through the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is the breath of God to heal Anton, to heal his lungs completely. I don't know that any of you even know he's suffering, but he has problems with his lungs. And so we're praying for a 100% total complete hearing, God's will be done, always in God's will, so that he can do even more to spread the flame of love, to speak about the power of Our Lady's flame of love. And so, Anton, you just receive, and I'll pray. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners. Spread the effective grace of thy flame of love over all of humanity, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So keep that prayer in your heart and continue to pray for Anton. And we'll pray for a great miracle. And we announced it here today on this show. If it happens, hallelujah. All things are according to God's will. And that's our prayer. So let's
say. Thank you so much.
So I wanted to start, Anton. I haven't started yet. Okay. Page 183 of the Blue Diary. Anyone who has a Blue Diary, it's page 183. It's a special book. Our Lady says, "For one to place a new instrument in your hands, it is the flame of love of my heart. With this flame of love, with this flame full of graces that I give you from my heart, ignite all the hearts going from one to the other. Its brightness will blind Satan. My flame of love is so great that I can no longer keep it within me. It leaps out at you with explosive force." So we have a sublime mission, and that's to propagate the flame of love. And Our Lady explains, to propagate it should be the principal purpose of your life, my little ones. So she's talking to little Elizabeth Kindleman. She's talking to all of us, not just Elizabeth Kindleman. To propagate should be the principal purpose of your life, my little one. We're her little chicken. We're not big. We're not in charge. She is. Help me to propagate this devotion. Elizabeth responds. Little Elizabeth Kindleman says, "My most holy mother, by the love which the Holy Spirit granted you, save me from falling into sin. Make me live and die in your blessed company." And then Gloria, "The glory to the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Pray constantly to the Blessed Virgin with this prayer. Our Mother, spread the effective grace of your flame of love over all of humanity. Amen." Each time you pray, invoking the flame of love for all humanity, Satan is blinded and loses dominion over souls. Help me to save souls. My flame of love will blind Satan to the same extent that all who spread it around the world. Powerful, powerful message from our Blessed Mother. Little prayer from Elizabeth Kindleman. It's powerful in the littleness, that in our littleness, in our little humility, what we can do by a little holy boldness, by sharing a holy card. I wrote to someone, here's something new, Anton. I wrote to someone just today. It was about some, anyway. My introduction on the email is Ave Maria. It's the month of May. I just said Ave Maria, you're so-and-so, here's what I'm asking you. The Ave Maria, he wrote back and he said, "In 38 years, no one has ever started an email that I received with an Ave Maria." And wow, he's starting to cry because that's exactly what we're supposed to do. He was stunned. He was in joy. He was so pleased. And it was just a simple little email. But think of what it did to him for today, if he truly meant it. I think he did. He's like, wow, everybody, look at this. Maria, then many souls are touched and the flame of love is spread. And I said, when I see him next, I bring him a book and a holy card. So
awesome. Wow.
That's a good thing. Back
well, that reminds me, just like, you know, how in grade school, you know, we would put JMJ on top of, you know, our you know, whatever homework or tests, you know, and I'd even do that in college. I'd put, you know, that, or I put the AMDG, you know, for, you know, at Maiorum Deum Gloriam, you know, for the greater glory of God, a Jesuit saying, but the JMJ, Jesus, Mary, Joseph. So that's awesome. Like, I just love hearing and seeing your emails and, you know, where you lead off that way. It is very beautiful.
it makes me pray before I write the email. If I put JMJ, I'm asking Jesus, Mary, and Saint Joseph to cover this email with their prayer, with their love, with their intercession. And I'm asking Ave Maria, and I'm saying Hail Mary. It's the month of May. It includes my feeling. And that's the other thing, is not just write it. Think of it when you write it, so that you just are with God, with our Blessed Mother, with Saint Joseph, that you do it with them, and it's powerful. So
also, I do want to interject, though. There's one thing that also that I think that distinguishes you. When you call, like when you call me, or when we're on different conversations, you love to start off, you know, by praying a Hail Mary. And that's also something that I haven't encountered with other people, that the first thing you want to do, and it's like you put the priority right then and there. If we have Our Lady, and this is where some people get, I guess our Christian non-Catholic brothers and sisters, they may wonder, like when we pray the Hail Mary, aren't you like worshiping her? But they don't really realize that the Hail Mary is actually scriptural. And the word that's in the center of the Hail Mary is actually the word Jesus. So we actually center our Hail Mary on Jesus. But it's not that we focus on her more so. We magnify Jesus through her lens. And so I just thank you for your example.
Yes. And the rosary is right from the Bible. It's the gospel. It's beautiful. The rosary is beautiful. Anton teaches on the secret of the rosary. Secrets of the Rosary, the great book by St. Louis de Montfort. If any of you want him to speak on that, call him. You'll never have another talk like that in your life the way Anton does it. There, I'm giving you another plug, Anton. Here we go.
Huh.
So one of the greatest lessons that Elizabeth Kindleman teaches us is the very beginning of the book. And she lets us know that God never abandons us. Well, Elizabeth Kindleman, before little widow in communist Hungary with six children in poverty, working three jobs. Her story's unbelievable. So read the diary. How did this lady who didn't have above a fourth grade education learn all the things that she's now? So her book is everywhere. The diary that Jesus and Mary gave her, all these beautiful writings, and they're true to the church. How did that happen without even a family? She was an orphan as well to teach her. And so read the diary for that. But that has always inspired me that God never abandons us since I read the diary. So I'm going to stop with that message for a second. And that's the flame of love. And I'm going to talk about the flame of love. But I really don't think many people know much about me. And I don't, you know, I'm kind of a hidden person. We have many, many leaders in the flame of love who speak and do a much better job at than I do. So I've always let others speak, but this time I think that, I don't know, but this year is my sixth year, and I another national director will be nominated and chosen very soon. And so just a little bit about me, and I think it will be inspiring. I hope so. So I grew up a cradle Catholic, Sunday Catholic, though. My family wasn't really devoted to the rosary. We went to Sunday Mass and all through Catholic schools, 12 years Catholic education, etc. I was born in 1951. In 1995, I was beginning to realize that I was nothing without God. And my life was a mess. And I was still a Sunday Catholic, most Sundays, that kind of Catholic. And no idea why I was going to church. I just went because it was habit. So I was kind of sad and often alone at that point in my life, 1995, and lonely. So I prayed. And I had a miracle. And this is the miracle that changed my life. And I was living in a condo on the second floor, and I heard what I thought was chanting from the apartment below mine. The people who lived below me, their names were Mary and Joseph. They had a family and very lovely people. I knew they were Catholic and prayed, but I didn't know them very well. So I put my head to the floor in my living room, and I listened, and they were praying the rosary. And I listened, and the tears began to flow. And I didn't even remember how to pray the rosary. I knew we prayed it at school and stuff, but it hadn't become a habit. So the miracle that happened in my heart was that it was opened to this new desire. I understood that now I wanted to know God, to know Jesus and Mary and Saint Joseph and the Holy Spirit, all the angels and saints, the Father. I wanted everything. I didn't have any idea how to go about it. I was not necessarily religious, but the desire. That word desire is so important. In the diary, Jesus says, What makes someone a saint? What saves and what keeps the person close to me is the continual desire of the will.
Oh, amen.
That also makes your soul beautiful.
Wow.
So that's from Jesus.
Unbelievable how it is exactly what you were feeling and desiring, and there it is in black and white.
There it was, yeah. So anyway, that was the beginning of my journey. And my prayer, I actually had a prayer that I prayed. I began to pray, "Dear God, if I only knew a priest, then all my questions would be answered."
Oh, wow.
And so I didn't know any priests. I mean, you'd go to Mass, but I didn't have any relationship. And so for everyone listening, our priests are very, very special. They're the only ones who have the sacrament of holy orders. They're ordained by God to be Jesus on earth. They give us the Holy Eucharist. The Eucharist is everything. Hallelujah. Our holy priests are everything. Pray for your priest, love your priest, help your priest. Right now in Philadelphia, probably all over the world, priests are dealing with so many things, especially being isolated. They're alone in their parishes. Many of them have 2 and 3 parishes. If they have a helper, they're so busy, they can barely share the things that they have to share. So they need the support and the love, mostly the love and prayers of the laity. Anyway, in 2010, so that was 1995. In 2010, God answered my prayer, and a very holy priest gave me a call. It took 15 years, but it happened. My own father had died in 1998, and this priest became for me my father on earth.
Wow.
He's much more than a spiritual guide. He's my friend. And I'm going to quote now from John 15:15. Jesus said, "I no longer call you slaves, because a slave does not know what his master is doing. I have called you friends, because I have told you everything I have heard from my Father." So
wow.
I prayed for a priest to help me. And from 1995 to 2010, and I'm going to tell you now what happened in 2010. So in 2010, I had so many miracles happen. I guess prayer. I had been asked to be a Eucharistic minister, Monsignor Graham at St. Denis in Havertown. And I was fumbling. I was such a nervous wreck. I said, "Father, I can't. I'm so unworthy. I can't." He said, "Yes, you can. Yes, you can." That's all right. So, Sunday Mass, I'd be shaking. And I'm like, "Oh, what am I doing here, Lord? Why did you do this to me?" That's the way it started. And a couple months after that, I was going to the hospital to give communion to the patients at the hospital.
Oh.
And I rode with a beautiful lady, Mary Lou Higgins, who I love. I don't know if you know Mary Lou. She's
yes.
So Mary Lou, I just met Mary Lou, went to the hospital with her. On the way home, we're talking about the patients we saw, and we ended up talking about Medjugorje, and we both wanted to go. Oh my goodness, we both were in love with Medjugorje. And I said, "Then we'll go, Mary Lou, sometime. We'll go soon." She said, "Okay." An hour later, she called me. She said, "Eileen, I booked the trip."
What?
This was August. I looked up the date. It's Wednesday, August 4th, 2010. And I said, "Mary Lou, I can't go to Medjugorje." She said, "We're leaving on August 25th. I said, "Mary Lou." She had no idea what my schedule was. She had no idea anything. Mary Lou is a very stable mother and grandmother. She has 4 children, many, many grandchildren. She's completely normal. Beautiful lady. I said, "You're crazy, Mary." Anyway, she said, "No, we're going." And I said, "Okay, well, I have to ask my husband." And I knew he wouldn't be interested at all. But "Frank, can I go?" And he said, "Well, him and Holiday said, I guess so." Anyway, let me tell you, the feast day of August 4th, it's the church celebrates the feast day of St. John Vianney, the patron of priests.
Wow.
And he was a parish priest, and he saw himself as unworthy of his mission as pastor. His humility and witness is well known. He revived the community's faith, and he gave very powerful homilies on the mercy and love of God. And St. John Vianney's feast day, I'm asked to go to Medjugorje, and I couldn't believe it. But also under St. John Vianney, pilgrims traveled from all over France to come to him for the sacrament of reconciliation, and how important the sacrament is in Elizabeth Kindleman's life, in my life, in all of our lives. Go to the sacrament of reconciliation. And I say reconciliation instead of confession, because Monsignor Cifo and Monsignor Majoris taught me that it's not about you confessing your sins as much as it's about reconciling yourself to God. They didn't say those words. That's how I interpret what they said. Reconciled to God, because that's where you're going to go. You're going home to heaven to be with God. You want to be reconciled with him when you die. So spend time at the sacrament. And St. John Vianney would spend 16 hours a day in confession and had no sense of sleeping or eating. He didn't eat. He's truly a great saint. He's known for his unfailing humility, gentleness, patience, and cheerfulness. So he inspires me through those great virtues. Anyway, back to Mary Lou. So Frank said, oh, I don't know. When are you leaving? I said, 2 weeks. Now you have to understand, my husband is legally blind. He doesn't see very much of anything. And so me leaving him alone for 2 weeks is not easy. And also, he's absolutely beautiful. Everybody loves him, but
yes.
He's not. You know, this is a hard thing for him. So he said, yes. I told Mary Lou, yes. I started to get things together. And a few days later, he says, well, Eugene, I think I'd like to go with you. And
wow.
I said, okay, then. No passport.
Oh, my.
Yeah. So we had emergency, or what do you call that? Urgent, whatever. You go to get the fast passport, speedy passport. And it came in the day we left, which was Monday 25th. It came in that morning. We had to be at the airport at 4 o'clock.
Wow.
Yeah, we just got in, and we both went. And it was a trip of many, many miracles. And Mary Lou and I became absolutely best friends. And anyway, so.
Incredible. Yeah.
So after that, I started two Medjugorje prayer groups. I had one with a group of people that I started at St. Denis Parish in our Grimes Center. And the other one, I invited my family. Now, I'm a family. I'm one of nine, and I have 100 first cousins. Or
close, really? Oh, my goodness.
200 or 300 second cousins. But I just put out a little group email to my family and said, would anybody be interested in coming to my home? And I chose, I can't remember the date. I'm going to have to look it up. It was spring in 2011. And this is another miracle. So it's important to share this. In 2011, I had just three responses, which is typical. I mean, it's the rosary, my family, you know. Okay.
Yeah.
They didn't answer. So, but I did have three answer, and I had five relatives. There were six of us all together. And you know all these people too, Anton. So it was just wonderful that they were coming to my home. So my home, which was still not particularly, I mean, I'm much more Catholic in 2011, but, you know, I'm still, you know, I'm always growing faith. I'm still not where I should be. But at that time I had, you know, I got an image of Our Lady. That I had one image of Our Lady. It was a beautiful picture. And I put it on the fireplace and I lit a candle, and it was about 11 o'clock in the morning. They were coming at noon, and I had the rosaries out and the prayer books, and there's a knock at the door. By the way, a knock is a sign of St. Philomena. I don't know if you've ever heard that, but I've heard that.
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
And I thought, who could that be? 11 o'clock. They're awfully early. I open the door, and it's four people from my parish that I didn't know. I knew their faces. And they were the Legion of Mary doing their rounds. And I said, oh, please come in. How providential that you're here an hour before I'm having my first ever family rosary, first ever rosary in my home. And it was Tini Iwano, Cecilia, I can't think of her last name, Rosemary Miller, and who was the fourth? Pin Iwano, might have been one other. And they come in, and everything's ready for them. Let's pray. We meet up early. It was so funny. And I'm like, why are you here today? And they said, well, we're just down doing our rounds. You're on the list. You're running the house. So I had belonged to the Junior Legion of Mary when I was 13, and I ended up joining the Legion of Mary after that, and became one with them for a long time. But anyway, that was, I think, just providential. So then my family came, and as Father Blunt says, we win. We always win. We never win, right?
Right, exactly.
So we had a nice lunch after the rosary, and they became my closest family, and I still do many, many things with them. So it's been a great joy to my heart that happened.
Well,
go ahead.
So the people from the Legion of Mary got to stay through the 12 o'clock?
No, they stayed for about a half hour.
Okay.
And they left.
They got to stay. All right. Wow. But it sets you off in the right. I mean, of all days, they would be there, and you had everything prepared, and as if you were anticipating them coming at the door.
That's exactly right, Anton. Isn't that amazing?
It is. God has a sense of humor. Our Lady does too. How she sets it up.
So I want to go back to 2010. I skipped ahead because Kathy Kemp came into my life in 2010. And Kathy Kemp is one of the greatest gifts from God that he ever gave me in my life. We loved each other very, very much. And God sent us out together. He always sends us out in twos. And so Kathy Kemp became my my partner. She became my sister. She became my friend. She became someone that we would seek everything that the Lord wanted to show us. Kathy used to pray at my parish at St. Denis. I would sit in about the fourth or fifth pew. She would sit in the beginning of the second half of the church towards the back. And we passed each other for years, many days, just with a nod. We didn't know each other. And one day she stopped me and she said, "What did that priest say?" And I heard it. And so I told her, and then we walked outside together and started to talk and instantly became best friends and totally connected instantly. Kathy Kemp's prayer, she told me this many times, the day that she met me and for months before that, her daughters had gone off to college. She was alone now. She had, she just didn't have enough to do. She would go to church and she said, "God, dear God, please send me a friend. I need a friend."
Wow. Oh my. Yes.
She used to pray, "God, I am lonely and my children are grown. I need a friend." Wow. It's quote. A month or two later, she invited me to go with her to a small group gathering to study the devout life, which was being taught by a very holy priest, a beloved very holy priest. And I jumped at the opportunity. I said yes. And so we would go once a week, every night, to someone's home. And there would be 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 people at the most, usually six. We were often joined by Tony and Linda Mullen. And this holy priest is the one who became my dear friend, very, very close friend that just called me. I don't know, just called me asking how I was doing. When he called a few weeks after the first time I met him, I was like shocked. And Monsignor called me at my home or something just to say hello. And my husband was there and I'm dancing. After I hung up, I said, "Monsignor, it was Monsignor." The impact of a call from a priest to just say, "How you doing?" was, I don't know, it just changed my whole life again. So there we have it. And so that's how I met Tony and Linda Mullen. And everyone in that group loved each other. And amazing grace came to all of us through this study.
The study of the Introduction to the Devout Life, St. Francis de Sales?
Yes.
It's amazing. Okay.
And so then after that, that's when Mary Lou and I, we were talking. We both wanted to do something. And I went to Carmel in 2011. It was that summer as well. And I met Anita, everybody. I met Anton, you were there. And so I met everyone and I said, "I'd like to discern this and pray and figure it out." And here I am all these years later. So here we go. That's the beginning of it. And anyway, I first began to understand the magnificence and the depth of our Roman Catholic faith and the unlimited abundance of gifts and blessings that I have available to me through all of these things that I just said in 2010 and 2011. We all have these gifts available to us. What I want to share is that they're available to everyone, not just me. I don't know why I got them. I don't know why, but you keep praying, the gifts will be yours. Each one of us gets specific gifts.
Yes. So, I think it's also because of, you mentioned that key word about desire.
Like desire.
St. Therese, the little flower, a doctor of the church in Carmel, as we know, said God doesn't put these desires in us unless it's good and it brings us to him. And so you had this desire, and then it was confirmed with you reading in the diary there about this desire that comes from God through Our Lady, and then here it is just flowering from the Introduction to Devout Life, meeting a friend, that became your best friend, and then the Carmelites, and then Medjugorje, just all like just coalesced into one, just in that burst of time, right there. It was like a big spark that jump-started you.
A flame of love.
Yes.
A living flame of love. Anton also desire in the diary, encourage everyone to get a diary and read the diary. It's so that quote that I mentioned was wonderful. But what I want to say is the desire, the greatest desire of Jesus, he tells us in the diary, his greatest desire is to be one with us. We are his greatest desire.
Amen. Amen.
With him. So the word desire, it's my desire, but he wants this desire. So the more I desire him, the more he wants to let me know he desires me.
Isn't that something? Yes. And also, if we throw in that word, that sometimes it's used in a different way, the passion of the Christ. He has this passion for us that he's willing to lay his life down for his beloved bride. And that's what he does. He loves his bride, the church. And we, as all brothers and sisters, are the church. And so, yes, this desire he has, this passion, and it comes out bursting in the flame of love through Our Lady.
That's beautiful, Anton. That is beautiful. It does. It does. Anyway, should I go back to my story?
Yes, please continue. Yes, I'm on the edge of my seat here. So, because everything is coalescing here. It's like all of a sudden, how many things come together? You got a free ticket to Medjugorje. Your husband's coming with you. You thought you'd know he'd go with you. You got a best friend, other best friends in Carmelite. You got the introduction to the devout life, but you're jumping on the deep end. So I don't think that's an introduction. You're going to the deep stuff, from introduction to the Carmelites, to the flame of love, to an Medjugorje and flame of love. Those are big time.
I think so too. And it only looks... It's so interesting. As things happen, you don't see them. But when you look back, you see our Kathy Kemp used to say, the one side is a mess, but on the other side, it's a beautiful tapestry that Our Lady weaves. And when you look back on it, you can see what the plan was, even though you had no idea why or how it happened. But you know you had nothing to do with it. It was all Our Lady.
Yes.
Putting it together.
Yeah.
And so that's typical Kathy Kemp. I miss her so much. Anyway.
Yes. God bless her soul. Yes. She's got a beautiful heart, tender heart. Yes.
So back to 2011, Anton, I was called to Medjugorje again. And this time my daughter and granddaughter, I decided to ask if they would like to go, and her husband, but her husband didn't come, but she came with my granddaughter, and it was really good because, you know, faith is so important. And I had an opportunity to share something with her, and she said yes. And that trip was so full of miracles. I have a writing somewhere. It was just an amazing, amazing trip. And Our Lady calls all of us to Medjugorje, not just me and my granddaughter. You go, you're going to have things happen. You'll have things happen over and over again. So it was the weekend of, it was the week of Divine Mercy. We were there for about 10 days, I guess. And we flew into Medjugorje. Miracles beyond my understanding. It was a beautiful group. One of the miracles that happened was, it was beautiful day, probably 75 degrees, sunny. We climbed Cross Mountain, which is quite a climb. And we got to the top, and she is at the bottom of the cross. My daughter's probably 38. And she's at the bottom of the cross, and she's looking up at the cross, and she says, Mom, come quick. It's raining on the cross. It was beautiful, not a cloud in the sky. My granddaughter's looking up. She was about 6 or 7. She's looking up at the cross, and I'm looking up, and my daughter's looking up. And instead of rain, it was gold dust.
Wow.
I've had any experience with gold dust, and I've had many. Brother Carmel, here's as a gift from heaven, and you can get covered with it. I've been with many people who've experienced gold dust. And so I didn't at the time. I had no idea. And I said, that is so weird. And here we're being covered with gold dust. I'm looking up, and I said, it does look like rain. She gets down her cell phone, and she starts taking a little video. And when the video's done, it looks like sparks, like little fire.
Oh, really? Okay, it's not like glitter. It's more like fire.
Yeah, all over the place. And so that was a miracle for us, just for
incredible.
Us sharing it, but an incredible gift of faith and confirmation of what we had done, that Jesus and Mary were with us. And for the little one to see that too, I think was...
Yes. Well, it's also independent. You have at least three of you seeing it independently, you know. So I don't know, were there any others that also saw it besides you guys? Because sometimes these miracles happen to just a select few, you know?
No, we didn't call anyone else over. That's kind of interesting. I never thought of that. it was like the first or second day of our trip. We didn't really know, you know, we didn't know people that well. And we just experienced it. We didn't, that's a shame.
Wow. Anyway, that's amazing. That is.
We didn't mean to be selfish, I hope.
No, but I mean, I guess in the shock of seeing this, yeah, that you're just beside yourself. You don't know what to do or say.
Yeah, we were. We were really shocked. The other thing on that trip was conversion of hearts. There was a young woman, 20, who went with her parents. She told them her parents told her they're taking her to Europe, and they ended up then going on to Medjugorje, which she wasn't aware of, and she was furious. She yelled and she cursed at them, and all of us heard her.
Oh, no.
And they were embarrassed, and she was upset, and she stormed off. By the end of the week, she was the most beautiful child of God.
Really?
Her parents, who was so glad she came because she connected with other people, and she understood what God wanted of her by the end of the trip. It was absolutely beautiful to see that. Other conversions for it. The other thing I saw on that trip was climbing up Apparition Hill with a bus driver from Brooklyn. His name's Jimmy Cavanaugh. I hope you're listening, Jimmy. And he was there because his sister was dying of cancer, and he had a family heirloom rosary. He wanted to bring it to the top of the mountains and have Our Lady blessed and the priest blessed, everything he could get from Medjugorje, because that was his sister's dream. Wanted to bring it home to her. And after this, the day after it happened, the day after this lady, young girl, hollered at her parents and was very angry. And we were on the way up the mountain, and he's holding the rosary in his hand. And he says out loud, "It's a miracle. It's a miracle. The rosary is changing." And many rosaries changed to gold there, and you could see it. It was actually visible to the eye, going link, from silver to gold.
Wow.
An amazing miracle. So he turns to the woman beside him, who happens to be this 20-year-old girl, and he said, "I feel that Our Lady wants you to have this rosary." He gave away the family heirloom that he
had left. No way.
He did. And it had turned to gold. And without thinking about it at all, he gave that to her.
Incredible.
A simple, humble man, a bus driver who saved to get there. Also on this trip, we had an extremely wealthy man with us who was, I guess, a little bit affected by his wealth that, you know, he had all the comforts of home weren't there. And he felt, he said it himself, I'm not speaking out of turn, at the end of the trip. He said what Jimmy had done, giving that rosary to this woman and hearing his story, had converted him so much he could never be the same because of all that happened. I don't know what happened to him at all, but I know he was absolutely blown away by the goodness and kindness of God. It's the definition of love by St. Paul. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is never rude. It's amazing. Amazing goodness and kindness and love. That's what he had.
Yes, for sure.
So, anyway.
Oh, that's amazing. Yes, because, you know, with all these different miracles happening, you know, as far as I remember, when Father Donald Calloway, who also had a big conversion because of, Medjugorje, reading the book, that he mentioned that there was maybe over 600 ordinations that has happened since the apparitions there, you know, and since 1981 to current. So, I mean, you know, base it on these fruits. I know there's controversy about the apparitions there, but then again, look at the different fruits. It's hard to, debate that when you see good fruits like the 600 ordinations into the priesthood, you know?
The fruits are amazing, but the controversy is only over the supernaturality of the apparitions. The first week, the Pope has actually blessed the first week, Pope Francis blessed that as being supernatural. And there, I think it was under Pope Benedict or Pope Francis, someone sent the envoy with the bishop. Bishop Hosher went there. And there's a presence with the bishop in Medjugorje now. So it's approved as a place of pilgrimage. Everyone's invited to go. It's absolutely a very holy place. They used to give out, I think, over a million Eucharist every year. I forget how many priests visit all the time. Absolutely 100% approved. But there's still not controversy, but there's still not determination on whether all of the apparitions are supernatural. And that probably won't occur until after all the visionaries are deceased or until the miracle
and
secrets are revealed. So it is a very holy place of pilgrimage. Yes, absolutely.
Yes. Well, with all this, it just seems, as far as in your story, how all these things come together to help launch you into a conversion from your whole life, from when you had that prayer in 1995 twisted that culminates in all these events, 2010, 2011, then you meeting Tony Mullen at that meeting for the introduction of, you know, the About Life, studying the works of St. Francis de Sales. And then here we go with the Carmelites and Mandigoria. So, yes, so take us further. You know, we're coming in about, we got probably like maybe 5 to 8 minutes here before the show ends, but we still want to at least get to how you got to into the Flame of Love. I know you met Tony Mullen there. So how does this all, when you come back after Medjugorje, then what happens?
I have to go back to Kathy Kemp. Anton, I went up to like...
Well, we're going to have to do... Yes, no, we're going to have to continue on to keep people, you know, on a cliffhanger here to part two for the following week, because, you know, it is very important to lay down the history of what happens, because I really firmly believe other people have something similar in their life. The audience that we have here on the network, they all had something that drew them into the Flame of Love, whether they came through Legion of Mary, the Carmelites, through some Bible study, through some prayer groups, through Medjugorje, through visiting the Holy Land, or some, you know, Fatima, something that Our Lady calls them there, because we are her children. And she's gathering up in her, protecting us in her mantle, because we are her children. And so this is how she's bringing us to her son. And so it's just wonderful to see this story in your life. And so I don't know what that you could share here. So is there other parts of Medjugorje that you want to share in that 2011, that second trip? Or do you want to take us back to the States again?
Well, since we have so short a time, what I'd like to do, if it's okay,
yes,
is just say... through all these things, the Flame of Love entered Kathy Kemp's heart as mm-hmm. well as mine, because we did this so much together. Everything we did together. And I think it's important for you to find someone, for everyone to find someone to pray with. Just one other person.
Wow.
More gathered morning, you know, just find someone that you yes. love. And you say a little prayer and you go do something or look at something or something holy online, whatever you can do. It's good.
Wow.
It's through Kathy and searching for God everywhere. But we went to all the shrines. We went to all the retreats we could find. We went to parish events, everything we could attend, 40 hour, you know, anything we could find. We went often to St. Mary Magdalene, because Monsignor Ralph Chifo at St. Mary Magdalene has always had many of the best events I ever attended.
He's amazing. Yes. And as far as...
That's how we became connected with the Sisters of Life. And pro-life ministry and all that we do in the Flame of Love. So, and Monsignor Chifo has the Sisters of Life there all the time. And so you find things. So find a priest and a parish. And the Flame of Love is in all these things. The diary of the Flame of Love, the messages that Jesus and Mary give us are new and unique. It's Jesus and Mary talking together, the same message to Elizabeth Kindleman, and they're telling each other the same thing. Mary will tell us about the desire, and Jesus will tell us about the desire. They'll tell us about, well, how you save souls. But so one thing, I don't want to get off on a tangent. If I don't stay organized, I'll be all over the place. Monsignor Ralph Chifo is the national spiritual advisor for the Flame of Love. He's often on our newsletter. His reflections are incredibly beautiful. He's given amazing spiritual direction. He was Tony Mullen's spiritual director. That's how he he's my Flame of Love spiritual director for the nation, East Nation. We're also assisted now by Father Mike Davis, who's wonderful as well, and other priests. So many priests have come on board to help us in any way that we want to be helped. But this is the love of God. It's our holy priest, and especially Jesus and Mary, their faces first, then our holy priest, through the diocese. And we have a beautiful list of statues, and everything has to really go through the parishes, through the diocese. But it's very important to stay all connected and all involved in all of this, so that we meet all the requirements that we're supposed to have set for us by the church and by our own love of God. God gives us specific directions. We better follow them. And if you don't know what to do, you better go see a priest.
You know, we definitely have to have you back on our next show, because we got a minute left now on the show here. So Would you like to have any short prayer or any parting words before we go off the air and then have you back for the coming week?
Yes, I'd like to pray the unity prayer to blind Satan. The power of this prayer, it's for everyone. The flame of love is for everyone, even the unbaptized. So we ask Jesus to be with us and Mary to be with us in the flame of love always. And we pray this prayer, which is Jesus's greatest desire to be with us. So we pray it. My adorable Jesus, may our feet turn together.
May our hands gather in unity.
May our hearts be in unison.
May our souls be in harmony.
May our thoughts be as one.
May our ears listen to the silence together.
May our glances perfectly penetrate each other.
May our lips pray together.
Mercy from the eternal Father.
Amen. Amen.
All right. Well, thank you, Eileen, for being with us here. And everybody, please join us again when we are here in 2 weeks, again, to have Eileen to finish up her testimony and to tell us about the past, present, and future of the Flame of Love and how it got to come to the United States, all the way from Hungary to South America to North America. So God bless you all, and thank you for joining us here again on the Flame of Love show on Radio Maria. This is Dr. Anton signing off with Eileen Piergiovanni. God bless everybody.
God bless you.